and perhaps approve the agenda, please. Thank you, Counselor Erickson. All those in favor? Contrary, motion carries. Thank you. Adoption of the minutes of the committee of the whole meeting on the 25th.
So.
Counselor Smith, moving.
Second.
Second, okay. Counselor Stewart. Questions or comments for the minutes? Again. All those in favor? Thank you. Station House Project, Mr. Philbosky.
Your worship, council, good evening. Earlier on, council had directed that the director of operations engage with Mr. Jeff Lawler, who's here tonight, to get cost estimates regarding the station house moving forward according to plan designs or preferences of both council and the public. You'll recall there was a bit of a consultative process and options were developed. So tonight, Mr. Lawler and my colleague, Mr. Dickett, are going to, I guess, reveal the results of the study and the estimates. And then I imagine from here would be some thought as far as courses of action, feasibility, and decisions to be made moving forward. Pass it to Mr. Dickett.
Your worship, the report before you is, as it indicates, based on the schematic design developed by Mr. Jeff Lawler with the input of stakeholders and the public and the District of Hope. And it's an attempt to be a fair market, reasonable price for a building of this nature in Hope. As you'll notice on page A1, the summary of estimated construction costs include $1.32 million for the building, site development at approximately $275,000, ancillary work at $91,000, contingencies at approximately $250,000, that totaling $1.93 million. There's a separate price item that was requested by council, or the committee, rather, to look into a fire suppression system for the building. And that comes in at $55,000. And that does not include the civil work, which would be to upsize the water service to the building. That I have estimated at an additional $20,000. Bringing the total for the fire suppression system to $75,000.
Questions? There will be lots. There will be lots. And just for the comfort of the folks in the public gallery here, this, as everyone recognizes, we commissioned this estimate to find out what it would cost if we were to move ahead without any pauses in the project. And this is sort of a Cadillac version of what we could do. But of course, it does not take into account the, it didn't limit it based on finances. So now we know what that would be. And obviously, it's a pretty penny, so we're going to have to look at all possible options that don't involve spending that much. So, Mr. Aiken.
One thing to note is this costing report does not take into account the fact that we have a considerable volunteer base in the community that's still in conversation I've had expressed interest in assisting with the project. Of course, we can't be certain as to the extent of that volunteerism, but it is comforting to know that we could perhaps leverage some volunteer assistance with the project to help control the costs, mm-hmm. and potentially lower the costs.
Okay, questions, contrary?
The questions I have is, this building is not an easy building to redo. There's a lot of problems with the building, and you have to have a contractor that actually knows how to do it. Volunteers cannot do it, period. They can assist maybe in some of the groundwork or taking apart, but as far as the construction goes, you need to have someone that's looking after the project from day one if you go ahead. Volunteers sounds good, but you cannot use volunteers when it comes to doing this specific work. Tearing off some of this up, maybe yes, but not when it comes to actually, you need to have a contractor to do this. And looking through this very carefully, like I did the other day, I think it would be cheaper for us to start from scratch and build a brand new. It'd be cheaper and you'd have a better building, less maintenance for the next 20 years. And then we could move the building where we wanted it, raise it up to what level we wanted it. And we wouldn't be spending $1.3 million on something that's old.
Okay, Mr. Provost. Your Worship, I thought maybe if it pleases you and council, maybe we can start with Mr. Lawler just going through the report, how we arrived at things, explain some of the logic in it, and perhaps that's a great segue from Councillor Erickson as far as an opinion at the end of it, as far as what Mr. Lawler sees as value for money and what options are available and perhaps what he may recommend at what price point.
We could go through piece by piece, but generally we approach it on the basis of solid but basic building. So I don't know there's an enormous savings to be made in terms of specifying different standards of work. This is what you would need. This is what you would want. I did have a talk with the cost consultant today. He actually left me a message. I haven't chance of discussing them directly. But talking about the cost of new building relative to renovating, this renovation is coming in between 80 and 90% of what a new building would cost. I mean, it's cheaper, but yes, you might well consider that a new building would be better value at this point. There are issues with the site. In its current position. It's not well located for access and circulation on site. So I mean, there are clear advantages in building new to get a better organization. In terms of building it, I mean, you really have two options in going forward. One, either tender it to a general contractor, which is likely to result in a price similar to what's in the report. You could appoint a construction manager, and his fee typically is smaller, and he's got the opportunity to negotiate with trade on an ongoing basis to get some savings. But in reality, the overall saving is not likely to exceed 5%. Now, 5% is significant, but it's not a silver bullet that's going to change the scale of the project. He has a better opportunity to incorporate donated materials and labor. But the point is well taken that the labor really has to be skilled. It's not for just anyone. I mean, there are certain tasks that could be done. But they're actually quite limited. The saving would be in having a skilled tradesman do it for free or very limited pay. You could increase the saving on the 5% to maybe 10% if things worked out well. So I mean that's the big picture. We can go through each part of the building, you know, reduce the standard of the toilet fixtures, you know, reduce the standard of the millwork, go with absolute basic floor finishes. But at the end of the day, this building has to represent hope. So how lean do you want to be before you start to say, this is not the picture we want to present? I know the finances are a problem, but that's the reality of building today.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I think this reinforces what council has done, this commissioning your services and other cost consultant was, I think, a very prudent move and makes a lot of sense. So I certainly have no regrets on that front because it's good to know what you're getting into rather than go blind and just throw money at something blindly. I think one thing this does do, since we now have a pretty clear picture of what we're confronting, if we decide to move ahead on this, I think there might be some really good opportunities here to pursue some interesting grant programs, because obviously we cannot do this alone. We just don't have the financing available for that, so it's just not something we can do. We'd probably get lynched with justification if we tried that. major investment this year in our pavement upgrade program, which is money we have to spend, so obviously that's where the majority of our extra resources are going, so. Encourage council comments on this. Silence.
Where to start?
Where to start, Council Millar? You gotta start somewhere, so we'll start there.
Well, I went through it and I'm not a construction, but I feel like I'm smart enough to see some things that shock me, right? So I do some homework and research. So I think there's a lot of things in here that are out of line, and I think it's a high estimate. When I looked at everything here, I guess my thought process is how much of the building is actually going to be left at the end of the day. Part of the project to me, most of the project to me, was the historic nature of that building being a 100-year-old building in Hope. Hope doesn't have a lot of its history anymore. A lot of it has been torn down and gone forever. And now I want to see us try and preserve some of what's left. I understand there might be some opportunity costs there, but I think it's well worth it. To the scale of this design, the only thing that's going to be left is the story and the basic shape. Other than that, it's a new building, right? I'm not in favor of that. I think we should really take a serious look at this whole process and where we've gone and go back to where the project intended initially and see what sort of an appetite there is for that. Maybe that means we don't use the basement. We don't have to deal with fire separations and things like that at this point. Maybe down the road there will be a grant that will be available and we can look at that then. But in the meantime, I want to do something with it because of the way it looks currently. I want to get moved in there so that we can function as a visitor center and museum. So it needs to look better than it does, but it doesn't need to look like that. I don't know of any 100-year-old buildings that would probably look like that. So that, to me, is brand new, and that's not what I intended. I don't think this project ever started off with, hey, let's build ourselves a brand new museum and visitor info center. I'm not a cost consultant, I'm not an architect, but going through this, I see some things that jump out at me. Little things that make me doubt other things, and maybe I'm just being skeptical, but I sell fire extinguishers. They're not $350 a piece. That's like five times what they should be worth. Makes me wonder about other numbers. I don't have the expertise to critique them, but I keep juggling in my head, what am I willing to spend on this building or current building? But I don't want it to look like that, like the roof, you know, $100,000 on the roof. That roof's not old. We just paid for that roof. We finished paying off that roof. Is there a specific reason why the roof needs to be replaced? Is there specific reasons why the windows need to be replaced? I guess those are questions I have. We got 40 minutes. I hope to get a lot of answers. And that's the discussion I hope to have here tonight. See where we go from there.
Thank you, Councillor Medlock. Councillor Smith?
I was going to echo what Councillor Medlock has said in this too. I think we've taken a turn hugely into what that project is. It wasn't, and I know how the steps that we did get to where we are now, and it's good information to get that we got it. So I don't feel like we wasted our money by any means getting to the information where we're at. But I don't think that building is intended for what we're doing with this building here. I agree with Councillor Medlock that it's just too much money to spend on that, and I think there's many resources we could echo through to get like Councillor Erickson said, can't have a volunteer do it. Well, that doesn't mean our volunteers aren't skilled tradesmen that we're going to be part of the project as well too. So I think we got to take into account that the people that would be volunteering towards the project are probably skilled individuals as well. We have very many skilled tradesmen in this community that have talked about wanting to, and people that have been a part of this project up till now too as well. So I fight on a lot of the numbers that are in there as well, but like you say, we paid for that.
Sorry.
We're fighting for that, but I'm not in favor of building that looks like that either. Like a tin roof, a 100-year-old building with a tin roof on it doesn't make sense to me. That's just my 2 cents as well.
Well, I think if this project is ever to move forward, it will have to have reliance on volunteer labor.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if we look at that Rotary viewpoint at the end of Wallace, I think that's sort of one of the real victories of volunteerism in the community. I don't know what that would cost if we would have, say, as a community, as a district, said we'd like to construct that concrete engineered viewpoint, and the District of Hope will pay the full shot. I would guess it's probably $250,000 project. I would guess 200 for sure. And you know, the Rotary Club, you know, raised money, which they're very good at and very effective at. And then there was a lot of volunteer labor that went into it. I mean, the final product is quite amazing, and, you know, quite a good thing for the community. So I think a similar model would, you know, if we were to get this jump-started eventually, would probably be a hybrid of volunteerism, successful grant, input from the district, obviously, but it's going to have to be pretty innovative. Councillor Erickson, Councillor Smith.
Regarding you, Jeff, mm-hmm. that was put together by Poole, Gordy Poole, mm-hmm. who was a contractor for years and years and years. We had an engineer design it. We had it drawn and designed, and then the Rotary Club put together with there was a lot of people that knew a lot about concrete mm-hmm. and knew a lot about how to put it together. It wasn't just, we had a lot of volunteers, of course, but it was, I was involved in that,
mm-hmm.
and it was a big take on for all of us.
Mm-hmm.
But the engineer had to be there, making sure that what we put together before we put the concrete, it had to be done by engineer work.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't remember what the cost was, but it's there. Yeah. But there again, we had someone that had done this before many times. It was his, he did come to construction for all his life. He put it together and met everyone. I would say if we could get someone, I'm just going to mention a name, like Jim Dent or somebody like that, that could come and manage the project, then I'm sure we could get it done for less money. Because he would do it voluntarily. But we need someone to look after this. We just cannot have volunteers come in there. Oh, you put this wire here. We need to have specific drawings, and we need to have, if we're going to go to the project. Volunteers, if you have someone that really knows what they're doing, and that can guide the volunteers, but I don't know, it's too big a project. You guys got to realize it's a big project. It's nothing, everything's crooked. Everything's shimmy. Go look at the walls. The walls are all different sizes. Some walls are 4 1/4, 4 3/8, 4 1/2, and just, they got them all shimmed. It's a huge project to make it look nice. And upstairs and downstairs, it's the whole thing, and the walls are sitting 6 inches off right now. Off the bottom, the top is a distance of 6 inches. But to make it look nice, it's a big job. That's why you have quite a bit of demolition costs in there, because things have to be taken down and put back.
There's a large section of the main floor that's all mm-hmm. the drywall that would have to come off.
I don't know. I understand you guys are coming from the right thing, but to me, if the town's going to put taxpayer money, people's money into it, we don't want to waste money. We've already put about $250,000, $300,000 into it. I don't want to waste another cent on something that, I mean, that's tax. It's every one of our money. I don't want to waste it. If we decide to go ahead with it, I'll back it all the way and I'll push it. So it's a lot of money, and I think we could build new for a lot less, and we could make it exactly the same. If you had a design build, a contract talked to contractor today. He said if they wanted to build it exactly that size, exactly that design, I would go through all the costs, and I'd bring it to council and say, this is what it's going to cost. X amount of dollars, and I'd build it with a couple of costs and bring it to the height you wanted. And it wouldn't cost us another cent to find out how much it's going to cost. Architect, engineers, it's all done by the contractors. Design build. And that's, I think, where we should get hired out for three people. Get three people to say, hey, we want this building. Let's see what they say. Now you've got a drawing. It wouldn't take much for them to come and take that and say,
They are only schematic drawings, so anyone pricing it would be pricing on the same basis. So it's the best guess at this point.
I think that's probably a valid plan of attack if we have some finances available to actually fund the project once the numbers come in. But if we don't have finances available to follow through on it, then we might be just wasting a little time here. Councilor Smith, do you have that?
Yeah, and I think on a brand new building would be, if we could put a brand new building here too, I think it'd be great if we do it. But I think the scope of the project gets lost when building a brand new building as well. There's people that have devoted, there's a lot of people that have put time in this building previously. And you know, and like Scott said, or Councilor Medlock said, the history is worth something. Regardless if that can be a heritage building or not, and we have to preserve an older building and spend a little bit extra money to go that way, there's some history there. And there's a pretty cool story about how that building got to where it is. Might not be the absolute ideal location, but it's always up council to go forward with this. And I believe it could be phased, and the general contractor that would oversee any of the volunteers obviously could not be just Joe Blow. It would have to be somebody, a skilled tradesman, to be able to oversee anybody that is volunteering in this. If you have a new building, or blow this down and want to put a new building up, I think your volunteer base that wants to come and help with this project would be very helpful, making the cost high for the new building. I think if we figure this out exactly the way we want to do it, I think the volunteer base will be there to help with this, and we can do it right, very, not cheap, but we're going to do it a lot cheaper than this, I believe. And maybe as we've talked about before, as a phased project.
So then if we do that, why didn't we get a volunteer base to come and redo the district hall? If we do that, you're right. I'm just asking, why didn't we get some volunteers to come in and rip the carpet out? We didn't. Because it's complicated. Volunteers can do some, I agree totally. But it's very complicated to get things organized and to get, you know, paint in and get the people to do the work. And just, I think, then this is a community building. It's not like a church or something like that. Because this is a community building.
Okay. Thank you, Councilor Erickson. Councilor Miller?
Why I think it's different than this building works is because of the public involvement in it to date. It dates back decades. People, you know, the community has been a part of that building. Yeah, the station house, not here. Certainly not here, right? But up there, it was run by volunteer organizations for decades. They're the ones that moved it in the first place, I believe, right?
Yeah.
So that's why it's different than here. And that's why I think there's still so much involvement. You mentioned Jim Dent. He was involved in the steering committee originally because of the history that he has and his family has with that building. So those elements are still a part of it. I would love to see the volunteers help out. And I think that a lot of them are probably fairly discouraged by the course of action that we've taken since their involvement. I think it's difficult to find contractors that are willing to work with volunteers. We were quite lucky with Barkley in that he was willing to try that, and it worked out good. We only got as far as we did for the dollar that we had put into it because of the volunteers. And that speaks to your point, how we need to move forward with that. But I honestly think that the volunteers are going to help us if we're there to help restore and refurbish the existing building, not retrofit it into a brand new building with the same look. I mean, if we're going to build a new building, my ideal wouldn't be this building. There's probably something else we could do for the same kind of money to build a new building. But I don't want to go down that road. The plan all along was to make the station house and the history part of that was why our visitor and info center. We've changed directions once before. I think we need to change directions again, back to the original plan, or a variation thereof it, in a phased approach that's more affordable, given the financial constraints that we all know we have. We've just gone through a budget cycle, I think. That building can't sit up there looking like it does for another year. there's got to be a way for us to do some work to the building to make it usable. It's structurally safe. We have that signed off by an engineer. Why can't we go back that way? Am I the only one that feels this way?
It's ridiculous. Oh, I thought you had your hand.
No,
I thought you were keen on
No, I'm just looking up some grant information at the moment here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm the only one that feels this way. I don't know why. We've gone so far off track that this is a different project altogether.
I don't know if we've gone off track. I think if we would have done this at the very beginning, when the town decided to take it over,
we would have dismissed it back then.
I think we would have dismissed it.
Yeah.
It's just too much money.
Exactly.
We would have said this is something.
We agree on that.
Well, I think we obviously have to decide on a path forward. We can't let the thing sit there indefinitely. And it is a nice work. It stays the way it is, and it's obviously not, you know, doing anything for us as a community. So, I mean, I definitely think a way forward has to involve obviously municipal investment, volunteer investment, and some well thought of grant applications, so we can have sort of a combination of a few items. Because we just don't have the money to contract this out and pay the full fare. I mean, you talk to anyone that's driven more than 5 minutes in this community, and if a significant amount of money goes into that building without having the roads redone, that there's probably going to be some potholes will be buried in, because it's not a good scene out there. So council has taken the leadership and invested heavily for this coming year in pavement upgrades, but we have to stay the course yearly, so there's not going to be a lot of extra money in the budget. Councillor Dyble, Councillor Harris.
Sorry for being late. So I've come to the party a little late, so I just want to know.
And it's just getting going, too.
Is it? Just wanting to know, is it an option to phase this project in? Is there potentials to phase the project in, if that's already been discussed or not?
The only phase that jumps out at me is the basement. Like, not do the basement.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I don't feel the main floor could be done in pieces. Not accessible.
Okay. I mean, I suppose I'm in agreement that the intent and the spirit was to keep the station house the way it was and to rally around the community support that we have for this project. Coming off the heels of the Cookahella Bike Park.
Mm-hmm.
I really believe that was the intent of council at the day, was to use that momentum moving forward. I'm not in favor of blowing it up and starting over from scratch. I'm in favor of looking at options and alternatives that would move the project forward in a way that has community buy-in, because there is significant community buy-in in this project. I think that there's options that we need to explore.
So if we did a phased-in approach, what would the first phase would be doing the exterior? Is that what you're thinking? Yeah, Victor? If we're doing a phased-in approach, you're talking about phase?
Well, I think that the clue would be we want to make sure we don't duplicate any work. So if there's any structural issues that have to be dealt with, we'd work with our architect, engineer, make sure that it's work that is done once and done properly, and then you wouldn't want to do the outside and then have some issues with the wall that you have to deal with, and then rip the siding off again and so on.
That would be all thought through.
Yeah. So I personally think we do have a lot of amazing expertise in town, and we do have a fairly senior population, so I think there's a lot more talent out there than any of us know. As far as people that are very skilled and passionate about, being a blessing to the community in some way, and if we can do some friendly arm twisting and get some, help. I mean, in an ideal world, we just do it up to snuff, spend the money, and make it happen. But we just don't have the resources for that. So. But I certainly don't want to see a duplication of work. So when the volunteers and we hire a contractor and combine it with volunteers, what have you, I wouldn't want to see volunteers see something come down that, you know, 6 months before they put up, because that's a pretty easy way to, you know, get people losing momentum, so. Councilor Minoff?
Thanks, and I'm glad you brought up the beautification of work. I mean, for me, that is where this whole project changed, was we were on track with the phased approach, and the reason we got to where we are today is because we did not want a duplication of work. So, you know, even our own building inspector had given us advice about fire separations from floor to ceiling, dependent on use of the lower floor. So that's where we got this idea, and, you know, Councillor Erickson brought that up as an option to take a look at the cost of doing everything all at once, so that we don't have this duplication. I was on side with that, because I don't want to see us spend money to tear it out and redo it. I really regret that decision, honestly, because now we're here, and the station house has been sitting the way it has. So, I assume that in a phased approach, there is going to be some duplication. I don't think the cost of that duplication is anywhere near the cost of this option, so I'm okay with that now. I have my question answered. I understand what the cost is. The opportunity cost is greater to me to not do anything and to have it sit vacant while we try and figure out a way to fund this. I'm okay with going back to not starting over, as Councillor Dival suggest, or didn't suggest, but brought up. I don't want to start right over. I want to pick up kind of where we steered off course, get us back on course, and figure out a way to make it happen based on the way we originally planned to make it happen. You know, selling of properties and all that sort of thing is a way to find out, finance it. Okay. I know it might not be the popular opinion, but in my opinion, it's the only way we've got to do it. The only way we can get it done.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm speaking on this phased approach. I've been thinking about the phased approach quite a bit, because we don't have the money. Town just doesn't. We don't have the money to work with it. But if we did the phased approach and we had a contractor that, I don't care who it is, just someone that's done this work many, many times and very experienced, and I think we'd have to do the exterior first, get the exterior done. And I'd even like to see the grounds taken care of. So when people come in, it's looking, we can do those grounds for a lot cheaper without paving. Not talking about paving, but we can make it look a lot nicer for, you know, the district of their point, put their crew in there, put some nice racks and cracks and grass, and really make it, even put some curving in if we have to, for a lot cheaper than 274,000. I think we can do that. And that, a lot of volunteers could be. We have people, you know, I got my bobcat sitting at home right now. He has a big one, so I'm just saying we could do it, but I think we'd have to do the exterior first, and we'd have to make a motion that, yes, we're going through this, but it's going to be over maybe 2 years or 3 years before we can get the inside completed. Mm-hmm. Because we don't have the money. We just simply don't. But the exterior is a good idea. It would be best to do the exterior first, and the interior comes as we can afford it. We can still plan all the outlets on the exterior, all the lighting, we can plan all that as we do the exterior, because it will all be under drawings. I'm sure.
Mr. Waller?
If I do the complete construction drawings, yes, which is my next phase, if I get approval. The building envelope is a two-part thing. It's insulation and drywall to the inside, and any services that may have to be installed. And then, some strapping and insulation finishes to the outside. It can be split into two parts. It is possible to do the exterior of the building as a separate exercise, but understanding it's not a full envelope. That allows you to finish the inside at a separate time.
Fair enough.
As well, thank you. I suppose my intent is to get it operational. With the intent, of course, to make it look good too. So, you know, there's a lot of things that we don't have to do to make that happen. $100,000 roof is one of them. Well, according to our professional, it cost $100,000, right? So, I agree with you, it's not going to cost $100,000. But that's my intent. I want to see it used. I'd love to see it by next tour season. So some works inside. You know, I stopped at the one in Kelowna and West Bank, I guess it is, a couple times over the course of 2 years, because I always get lost walking through there for whatever reason. And they were under construction. They have a visitor info center with a museum attached to it as well. And they were under construction for those full 2 years. I don't think there's anything wrong with that. It shows that we're working on something bigger and better. Just gotta be smart about it, right?
Cost of materials.
I don't know that it costs that much more. Perhaps it does, because some things will cost more.
Councilor Crump.
So a little bit of a mind-blowing evaluation at the end of the day of what's really the cost in these proposals anyhow. I can't live in the past. I know that I wish that we would have had those figures in the beginning myself. It would definitely have not been something I would have appreciated seeing. We wouldn't have been able to do it clearly, and we would not have encouraged everybody to jump on board and climb in and go for it like we did. We did a few things backwards, I think, in the beginning, and we're trying to rectify that. And you know, I think we deserve some kudos for recognizing that part and going forward. But you know, at some point we have to put a cap on the money, the bleed. At some point we have to say how much we expect the taxpayers for the value of the volunteers and the history to pay to continue the project, like, in my opinion. And I feel that if we want to have something on the corner, which is ultimately what I want personally, my own personal opinion is I want something on that corner to be inviting and wonderful to come in, to be useful to the whole community and to the newcomers that come to our community and appreciate the work that we do there. But I don't want it to be at the division of our community. And that's something that I don't know if we recognize, but I think that there is a division in the community with the project. And the station house has a history of being a bone of contention for one reason or another, which you and I know more than anybody else sitting here, I'm sure. And so the point of it is that, you know, I like to keep people pulled together and on board and with a vision in mind, but I really need to see the final price that we're willing to pay and be able to vote on that and go from there. Because at this point, these numbers are just astronomical, and it's just way not even worth looking at phasing in, because where does it stop? I mean, we have to look at what our ultimate goal is going to be, what we can afford. And if there's grants that are coming later, wonderful, we can add to the project. But at this point, we need an amount, a dollar figure. What are we going to pay as taxpayers? I want to know. Like, what does council feel that they want to continue bleeding to death with? I want to know what we're going to end up paying at the end of the day. And if we phase it in, whether it's $1 or $100,000 or, you know, $600,000, I need to know what that figure is. And that was the whole idea, I thought, of getting an engineer and getting a perspective on what the real hard costs were going to be and taking it and jumping off from that point. This is not doable. So where are we?
Well, you know, I think we all know we can't spend the money on this project. But I don't think that using the term stop the bleed is necessarily an appropriate term, because...
That's the way I feel, though.
Yeah, I mean, it's maybe a feeling, but it's not necessarily reality. The reality is that we received the fee simple land essentially at minimal cost, because our administrator was very innovative in acquiring that from Highways. So I would see that as a huge you know, X in the box as far as a value added for our community. That's a big plus. Getting the initial work done to make it structurally sound to an extent, probably not a waste of money either. And then there was a, I think, a large sentiment in the community that people were saying, well, why don't you just, you know, do the Cadillac version, find out, you know, how much it would cost to do this up to modern standard, essentially. And so I think we now know. I don't necessarily think that was a waste of money. That's something we can put to bed, obviously, because we just don't have the resources to make that happen. But it was a question that was asked by many, and it's a question we have answers for. So I don't necessarily think there was a waste there. I think the waste would have been not doing it. There would have been a lot of ambiguity and hard feelings and so on and so forth. So yeah, it did stall the process. But now we really, I'm the $6 suit guy, so thrifty is what I'm all about here. So thank you. I like it too. So my point to this whole thing is I think there's some ways to be innovative and save a lot of money and still come up with a reasonably aesthetically pleasing product that embraces the heritage of the building. So, you know, path forward might not be super easy to figure out, but we have to do it sooner than later. So, Mr. Dickman.
So, based on the feedback from tonight, it's been a really great dialogue.
He says it with a straight face.
Yeah.
You're good.
Yeah, no, it has been really good and very informative for staff from my perspective. Perhaps I should work with Mr. Lawler and Mr. Lyndon Thomas to come up with a phased approach to the project and look at ways that we can potentially reduce the cost as proposed. And I'm assuming this is something that would be feasible, Mr. Lawler.
Absolutely.
You know, one item that has been brought up tonight is the roof, and the roof is not all that old, and it appears to be in good shape. So, you know, that's a $100,000 plus item in the report that perhaps we can do without a new roof. So, if the committee is agreeable, I'll work with Mr. Lawler and the cost consultant and come up with a phased approach, phased plan, and we can certainly assign costs to those phases based on a more conservative approach.
I have some questions that hopefully Mr. Lawler can answer when he's here. And I'd like the idea of investigating the phased approach, and I want you to have the $6 suit mentality. Because he looks good. Right? And that's what we want. We want it to look good. We're putting our image out there, right? But some of the things I found in here I didn't understand, so I just wanted to get a little bit of clarification. On one of the things you've got, maybe this is more of a cost consultant thing, but I'm sure you guys have had this conversation based on your design, right? So ceramic wall tile is in there. Is that like for the restrooms?
Yes.
Okay, is that the only option? Is there less
expensive No, only to reduce it. There's a minimum amount of impervious wall finish required for only more.
Yeah.
That's it.
So let's look at that.
So, I mean, right? we could take that out. But again, you're down to design issues.
Yeah.
Yes, it's a saving.
But these are the things that add up to hundreds of thousands of dollars that we don't have, right? The kitchen, you got upper cabinets, lower cabinets, it's $10,000. Like, my wife would love for $10,000 worth of cabinets in her kitchen, but she's not going to get that. This is for staff use, it's not a commercial kitchen, right? We've got a $2,200 stainless steel fridge, like those type of finishes. I think if this is the theme throughout this whole report, those all need to get kicked down a big notch, right? Again, the appliances, you know, just to pick on them, while it'd be great and whatnot, it's a staff room, fridge, dishwasher, microwave. You know, I assume these prices always include installation of the items.
Well,
but a microwave for $450, you can get for $150 that'll heat up some soup and you just gotta plug it in, right? I went through this all looking at it and shaking my head on a lot of it. The other question I have, I guess, that's more related to an actual part of the project is the garage doors, the overhead doors, and the coverage for them. So there's two of them, right? I understand the one in the front there.
No, actually, there is only one. The others are just...
Well, you got it in here. Two of them, $3,600 a piece and $4,200 for automation.
I'm sorry, There's one at the front and one at the back.
Okay. So I understand the one at the front. The idea that I remember about that was twofold. One, we need a large space in the building to be able to get cabinets in there that we already own. So with an overhead garage door, is that still something that's possible? Have we figured that out? Because that's a, I don't think there was a lot of clearance.
Well, the
based
door
on the
hole
that's
made,
already there.
It wouldn't be a standard without a Home Depot, but you'd have to have it custom made. It's a
okay.
Situation.
I do like the idea of having that with the covering to make it look like the historic building that it is. And I also like the idea because I think the idea was not to make waste of that by just using it as an opening to get some cabinets in, but to be able to open it up during events or whatnot to have some sort of free-flowing sort of thing, right? So that's okay. But the second one downstairs, what's the purpose with that?
Well, that was for museum storage. You're bringing the things out from down there and bringing them up.
Okay, and that, was that deemed to be something that was needed or necessary, or is that just a nice to have?
Same rationale as for the one at the top. If you bring in large items, you need a door that can handle it.
Okay.
It has to be insulated for the winter time. It seems like the same solution was appropriate.
So there was some feedback from the visitor center people sitting behind you there about needing a garage door on the basement level for storage?
Yes.
Well, it's the same rationale for the upper one, because I understood items would be moved from the storage down below and up to the upper level to the museum itself. Not on a regular basis, and annually, I thought. I mean, if there are no large ones being stored downstairs that have to be taken out, then the regular door could do.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, on the same theme of keeping it down, you know, you got the auto assist in there for $4,200 on that overhead door. I assume it's on the overhead door.
It's for the entry.
Oh, okay, is that for disabled? Okay, so that's in there twice then. Is there more than one of those required? There's one.
Both vestibule doors.
There's two, one upstairs, one downstairs?
No, one for the outer door and one for the inner door.
Oh, okay, so you need an automation on both of them. Okay. So I understand there's some code things here. So that's the other thing. If we take the step back that I'm hoping that we can look at, as an option, where are we with all this code? I know your answer is going to be we must do these things, but I want to hear from our building inspector because I think she's the one that needs to answer that question. She's the one that needs to sign off on these code requirements, right? So I'm hoping to get an answer back on that the next time we have a discussion surrounding this. I thank you for your time, Jeff, but you got to help me see a light. It's not the one I wanted to see, but I saw it.
Even it's light at the end of the tunnel with the train coming towards you.
There we are.
Right.
Yeah. Going along with what Councilor Scott was saying, we can't really nitpick all these costs, and that's why you have a contractor to do it. That's why you have a contractor to come in, and the contractor deals with the district or Kevin or whoever, and says this is what we can do and this is what he does. So it's a discussion as the contractor is going through the project. Do you want to spend this amount of money on
this? Our decisions?
It is our decisions. We say we have so much money. Mm-hmm. We're going to say how much money we have. That's what we have to do. We have to come up with the money. That's the first thing we should do. We have $850,000 we're going to spend on this building. And if that's what we're going to spend on it, that's what we're going to spend on it. So now we have to work everything in that $850,000. And then I mean, I'm just taking a number. I'm not saying that's the number. I'm just taking a number. That's the first thing. And then the next thing we should be talking about is the time frame we want this done in. This is how you start a project. You find out how much money you're going to spend, the time frame, and then you hire an architect and an engineer and make it on that. But we're too far down the line, and we need to hire a contractor now, or someone like, I'm saying Jim Dent again, I don't want to take his name, but some guy like that, that's very expert in all this area, and say, Jim, can you come and take this project over? And he will come in and he'll sit down and he'll say, you have $850,000? I'll fix it for you. I'm just saying a number. And that's what we have to do. And then we'll start right from the very beginning. Then we don't have to nitpick, oh, this is good because we've seen it's all written down. And for a fridge of $2,500, well, you might get the fridge for $1,800. Who knows? But it's what we need. But that's not ours. us as a council do. Ours is to figure out the big picture. What we're going forward.
Can I come on up?
Go ahead. I remember a discussion here, yourself, Councilor Erickson, mentioned that that was part of our job, was to say this is the type of toilet we want, this is the type of sink we want, and those kind of things. So that's why I'm picking it apart, because I don't think we had any sort of say in it. We haven't even said how much money we're willing to spend, and they're putting these high, in my opinion, higher-end finishes in there. That's why I want to say, for me, that's not what I want to see. I want to see something more reasonable, more suited to what I believe to be our budget.
Yeah, but from day one, I've talked about procedures that we have to do in the building, that we have to go through this line. Then you get things correct. If we don't, then we miss things. That's what we've done.
Okay, so we're rapidly running out of time here. So that there's clarity for staff, I think it's important that we have a motion here that gets shot through to the council meeting. And so Mr. Dickens' thought is, and I think it's a good thought, to work with Mr. Lawler put together some options as far as a phased approach. I'm looking for a motion of that effect from committee so that there's no ambiguity when it comes to, so the staff isn't hanging out in the breeze here if there's some ambiguity, shall we say. So like, motion would be in order.
Sorry, before we do the motion, can I just say that if that's the intent of the motion, it needs to have money attached to it, because I'm not going to go forward with the motion that does say, yeah, we'll do a phased approach, but for how much? I need to know what that's going to look like.
Well, I mean, first, is it possible to have a practical phased approach?
Okay.
So hopefully in a couple of weeks, Mr. Dickin and Mr. Lawler can come up with some ideas as to, okay, what is required? Phase one, a realistic phase one, given a budget, would be X, Y, and Z. And then, yeah, and the timelines attached to it and so on and so forth. So,
what would you hope to achieve in each of the phases? Looking at phase one, I mean, at some points, it may become occupiable.
Yeah.
But not doing the basement and only doing the exterior of the upper level wouldn't permit you to actually occupy it. So, if you've got a phase one, stage one.
Well, I think that the comment that we brought out, and this is something I certainly agree with, is, you know, let's make sure we don't duplicate work, make sure that the structure is sound, so that when we do exterior work that makes it aesthetically more pleasing, that we don't have to redo any of that exterior work, but we do have to clean that place up from the outside. It has to happen. And that has to be a priority, because we just can't let that thing sit there looking at that tourist community.
Would the intent of phase one be to make it occupiable and presentable within the budget limit that you say you had, $850,000?
Well, I just made that number.
Oh, okay.
That's not my. I would like to see it above.
But if there is,
we could do it for that.
Right.
But I don't think we have a budget identified right now in solid terms. There's some ambiguity as far as where this Kinder Morgan money is going, because, you know, previous council had an idea, we had maybe slightly different ideas, so we want to get to the you know, the meat of that issue here shortly and decide where that money is going to go, if it indeed does come to our community, if the pipeline does go ahead. Because as you know, Mr. Lawler, we're getting if the pipeline does go through, there's a amenity agreement of $500,000, so there's mixed opinions as to where that should be invested. So important, there's some clarity there, and that will of course decide on how big our budget for this is. So I just think practical steps forward in phases. Yeah, occupancy is a goal, but I mean, obviously it would be nice to have it cleaned up on the outside even before it's occupied, because you know, the tourist season's coming up. We're probably not going to have it occupied this summer regardless, given our, you know, $6 suit budget here. So the reality is that's not going to happen. But we can clean it up to make it aesthetically pleasing, so that when, you know, that when people come through, hope it doesn't look like we have a haunted house at the entrance. So, that, you know, I think that's a realistic, you know, first step forward.
Should have done
that.
Yeah.
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 Well, I think we could probably work on both of those options. Back to committee to say, well, this is, if we focused on the interior of the upper floor, you know, this is what we could squeeze the cost down to. this is what would be required to make it occupiable and functioning. And then we could also look at the option of just cleaning up the exterior, present both those options and the costs associated, as well as I'll have a conversation with Mr. Quarters as to how much money we can reasonably tap into in our reserve to get going on an aspect of the project.
But I think a natural progression would obviously be clean up the exterior, get the inside habitable, because you don't want a nice interior and then the thing look like a crack shack. That doesn't make sense. So we want a nice, aesthetically pleasing exterior. And then if we're occupying it, then people, when they come in, they have expectations that we, you know, have something decent to show.
Another note is, if we're going to seek grant funding on the project, we have to be very careful that if we are phasing it out, that if we do get started on our own in the absence of grant funding, that we work on a single phase and then we would apply for grant funding for an additional phase.
Yeah.
We haven't yet started.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so makes sense. Yeah.
That's a piece.
Total sense. Yeah. I like it.
So sorry, I guess I hate to be a pain in the butt, but on the other hand, I want to know if we're voting on phases, like, I don't really feel comfortable even doing that without a number. I need to know how much money we're going to spend. And if we have a budget of $5,000 or $500,000, then we can decide on actually what phase, if we're doing a phase, that we're going to work on. Right now, we're saying we're going to go ahead and come back, get stuff to come back with phases and costs associated with those phases. But how much money are they going to be looking at?
Well, I mean, that's the whole point of us getting more information at the next meeting. We don't have any of that information now, and we'd like to get that information. So, to me, clean up the exterior, make it look decent, and find a way to get it habitable so that we can use the building. I mean, there's two first step phases, and a lot of the exterior work and the grounds and so on, I'm sure there's some extensive use of volunteers that we can leverage in the community. But people have already volunteered to come forward and say, hey, when you decide exactly what you want, we'll be there for you. So I think that's the kind of momentum we don't want to see lost. So there's some, and certainly I guess Mr. Dick and Mr. Lawler, the thought would be that the exterior grounds would be included in that discussion at the next meeting. So there would be some thought as to if we contributed some labor from the district, from our personnel there, and then we had some already identified volunteer equipment and labor, you know, how much could we do it for and produce a reasonably aesthetically pleasing result and not duplicate work for the future. So do something that has to be ripped out in the future. So so I would just like a motion from this committee requesting staff to follow through on Mr. Dickens' idea so that he's not sitting in a leaky rowboat at the next meeting if there's a change of opinions or what have you, that we're all on the same page or a majority anyways. Yep, Mr. Councilor.
Okay, maybe in that motion we can have Dale give us some idea how much money we could use this year toward this phased approach.
Yes,
for the next 3 years.
That was part of my suggestion, was that I would have a conversation with Dale as to what money we do have that we can access for this purpose, so that we know what we have at the moment to get us started on whatever we decide we want to start on.
Okay. Councilor Stewart?
Could we just make sure that that is included in the motion, and then I'd be fine?
Yeah.
So if we could put the wording in the motion to include the conversation with Dale, I'm fine with that.
So essentially, staff would be directed to come up with phased options for the moving forward with the station house project, and then there'd be some
so not only cost, but resources, financial resources.
Yeah. So you're still moving, I hear that.
Then I will move that.
Okay.
If that is
Sounds
included
awesome.
In the wording.
Yeah. Okay.
I'll second it.
Otherwise,
okay.
I won't.
Moved and seconded. Okay. All those in favor?
Can I just have a comment? Sorry. One more.
Okay, sure. Okay.
So I'm not really going to be in favor of this. The reason is because, to me, it's no different than where we were at the beginning. To me, it's like we don't have we don't have a budget. We don't know how much money we want to spend again, and we want to phase. We have put some money aside already in our budget, so we do know what, technically, we do know basically what we can or will have to do something with, and yet we don't have a total figure that we want to spend on this.
We have not identified a specific figure, period.
Right, we haven't. It's a problem.
So my other comment is, by voting for this, we vote for it, does that mean we're going ahead with the building project?
No, we're exploring options. We're seeing, is a phased approach a possibility for this project? It's exploratory exercise.
That's what it says.
That's exactly what it is.
We're going to produce a report.
And I mean, this is committee anyways, unless council ratifies it, means nothing anyways, so. There we go. Motion's on the table. All those in favor?
I'm opposed.
Okay, please note that. 5-minute break and then we'll hit council.
Thank you.